If you have lived in the suburbs before, you probably have experience of visiting a suburban shopping mall. Just like any other places in the suburbs, it is usually not easy to reach by any other modes of transportation besides an automobile. When you arrive at the mall, I have to admit that it is one of the few walkable and dense places you can find in the suburbs. However, you would find yourself surrounded by a huge parking lot, which perhaps is even bigger than the mall itself. But suburban malls weren't meant to be this way. The original designer of suburban malls had way more ambitious plans for how it would be like. So, how was suburban malls invented? How did it become the way it is today? And what can we do to make it better? Let's find out in this video. Like mentioned in my previous video, the kind of suburb we see today started to boom across America in the mid-20th century. With the post-war economic boom and the construction of the interstate highway system, more and more Americans moved out of the city living in single-family homes. Unlike the previous types of suburbs, post-war suburbs were extremely spread out. There was a lack of community and a place to gather. And this is when one man, Victor Grün, came up with the idea of malls. Victor Grün was an Austrian Jewish architect who immigrated to the U.S. in 1938. He wanted to replicate European-style town squares and bring them to the growing U.S. suburbs. In 1956, the Southdale Center opened in Edina, Minnesota, becoming the first fully enclosed indoor mall in the U.S. It was a large and spacious building containing modern shops and arts with a climate-controlled environment. The creation of suburban malls allowed suburbanites to gather, shop, and socialize without going to the city and soon gained popularity among Americans. After the initial success, over 1,200 malls were built across the country. While Victor Grün was named as the father of shopping malls, the direction the malls went wasn't what he wanted. He once said in an interview, "I refuse to pay alimony to those bastard developments. They destroyed our cities." In fact, Victor visioned the Southdale Center as a new high-density, mixed-use district surrounded by housing and offices, as well as a school and a medical center, with an artificial lake wrapped by curved streets, all forming a utopian blight-proof neighborhood. In other words, he wanted to replicate a dense, walkable downtown in the suburbs. However, with land value raising around the mall, the developer company of Southdale decided to build single-family homes around the mall instead of what Victor visioned. This has resulted in the classic look of suburban malls across the U.S., huge parking lots, multi-lane roads, and sprawling landscapes. These suburban malls were mostly only reachable by automobiles, meaning people who don't own a car would have a hard time reaching it. The rise of suburban malls also caused a devastating impact on downtowns. The market share of main streets and cities dropped from 80% at its peak to 5%. Malls continued to increase in the post-war era along with suburbs. It was soon being known as an institution, a prominent fixture in the cultural zeitgeist of suburban life. The change came at the turn of the century, when there were massive waves of mall closures. In 2017, the real estate research firm Green Street Advisors rated more than 300 malls with a health grade of C+ or lower, meaning that it is in a risk of closure. The decline of malls could be chased down to a few factors. While online shopping is one of them, there are many other factors. The suburban sprawl encouraged the construction of more and more malls, leading to saturation of the market. At the same time, the sprawl was also unsustainable, and as people moved away from the mall, the malls fall into a decline. Many also believed that even Victor Grün's original vision of malls were built. It still could not avoid many of the problems. The sprawl environment usually meant that people always needed an automobile to get around, so the replicated downtown in the suburbs under his vision would still be centered around automobiles. So despite Victor's vision itself being great, it may not work out in the suburban environment it was being put in. So, is there a solution to saving suburban malls? Well, instead of saving suburban malls, I believe it is more important to think about what we can do about the suburbs as a whole. Before the automobile rise, suburbs used to be walkable and centered around public transit. That should be the type of design we return to. We could consider bringing back some of Victor Grün's original vision of a mall, but at a larger scale so it could reform the entire suburban environment. We could achieve it by improving transit access, building better infrastructure for pedestrians and cyclists, and rezoning land for mixed-use development. By increasing the amount of people getting around the suburb by modes other than cars, the parking lots around the malls could also be repurposed for mixed-use development with residential homes on top of retail stores. These developments do not have to be high-rises. It could be low or mid-rises that still keeps the characteristics of suburbs. So what is your opinion on suburban malls? Do you agree with the ways I propose to improving them, or do you have your own idea? Share with me in the comments. If you want to learn more about the development of American suburbs and how it became the car-centric suburbia we see today, you can check out this video where I talk all about it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in my next video.